Hi. Thanks for coming back for the finishing touches on my episodes about touch. I am Trace. This has been a crazy experiment. I really hope that you've enjoyed it. Earlier, we talked about what touch is physically, what it means emotionally, how we need it, and what happens if we don't have it. But now you're aware. Touching is a thing. It's a big thing, and we all took it for granted before. Today I'm gonna blow your mind a little, and then later I'm gonna do it a little more, and you know the idea of an optical illusion. We're talking about touch illusions. So stick around, and let's kick into this. This is gonna be so fun. Touch is a strange sense. It's complicated. It's hard to imagine having five different types of eyes and making sense of the world, right? Or several different ears all working together to hear the world around you. Touch is like that, though. Remember, you've got all of these different cells, some in your fingertips, some in your hairy skin, some inside of your own body, and they're all doing one or two things, and together they give you this unified, super sensitive, essential sense. And that takes up a huge part of our body, literally all of our skin, all of our insides, and some of our emotional processing in our brain as well. And yet, because it's all of these different things working together, you can trick it rather easily, and in fact. So picture this. I blindfold you. I hand you an embossed paper with a raised relief of a shape, say a car or a pair of scissors, you know, something common. You would have a lot of problem figuring out what that is. Even with an embossed piece of paper with a raised relief, feeling it alone with contour, that isn't enough information for the brain usually for most people, even with all our powers of touch. It might be different for people that are used to handling things, and that's something that's really fascinating. You can train your sense of touch to be more sensitive. Diana talked about that a little bit earlier. But touch can change our moods and affect our brains and be overwhelming, but it's not unbeatable. You can try this at home if you've got an embossed card with something on it, or you're able to make something like that. You can even use paint, but it's not gonna be even, so it might be hard. This other one though, you can try at home and it's fascinating. Grab a friend and a rubber or fake hand from like a Halloween store or a mannequin or something like that. Put your arms on the table with your palms down. So move one hand over and hide it behind something like a board game box or something where the person can't see their own hand, but the partner, they can see the hand. The fake hand should be in between the two. So it will look, if you, didn't pay attention to where the arm was, that they have one fake hand and one real hand. Now, the person who's doing the experiment should take a paintbrush in each of their hands, two paintbrushes, and touch the backs of the fake hand and the real hand at the same time. It might seem strange, but if the partner strokes the fake hand and the real hand softly and slowly with the same exact movement over and over, within a minute or two, the person who cannot see their real hand and only can see their fake hand will fall victim to the touch illusion. They will think of the fake hand as their own hand. Their brain will move the touch inside their bodies, remap it to the fake hand. In studies done with this over and over again, when they ask the subject to use their free hand to point to their hand, their other hand, they point to the fake one. They don't reach over the game box and say, oh, my hand's over here. They just point to the fake one and they say, oh, that's my hand right there. The body takes ownership of the fake hand. It's amazing. Admittedly, it might be tough to do at home. You might have to try it a few times, but it works and it is crazy. An FMRI study found that the premotor cortex was engaged while the stroking was the same. If you don't stroke the hands at the same time or at the different meter or whatever, it won't work. Part of the brain used for visual and touch processing takes over this fake hand. Psych students are subjected to this all the time. They do the whole experiment and then someone will smash the rubber hand with a hammer and the students will freak out. Because neuroscience studies have found, quote, the brain no longer considers that fake hand as outside of the body, but instead part of the body. In fact, if you look in the brain with fMRI studies, there's decrease in activity in the brain for where the hand that was behind the box was, because we didn't need it. Isn't that amazing? Anyway, a 2018 study in Nature used this rubber hand illusion. They used the same setup, but they had the first person view of an experimenter. First person is familiar to some of the gamers, but it essentially means like, imagine you were looking out of somebody else's eyes. So even though I'm sitting here, I would be looking like you were looking at me. So I would see my hands, but I'd also see your hands. A little confusing. Regardless, they saw four hands. And instead of one fake and one real hand, they saw their own and someone else's. The participants would be told to tap their index finger. So they would tap their index finger. And the experimenter, remember, they're looking out from the experimenter's view with like a little camera. The experimenter would imitate it with their own index finger. They would use a paintbrush and touch the back of people's hands, and they would do it in sync with all four of the hands. And the amazing thing is, they didn't think, oh, these two hands are mine and these two hands are someone else's, which is maybe where you thought this was going, right? They would take ownership of the experimenter's hands. No. They took ownership of all four of the hands. If they did this experiment right, you were a four-handed person for like a few minutes while this experiment was going on. If they imitated what motions that you wanted to be doing and they did it well enough, you had four hands, or at least your brain thought you did. Super weird, right? Lots of discussions in this study. It is not perfect, but it is a super cool concept. And it just illustrates again that the brain is super plastic and amazing. It's not the only touch illusion. I wanted to do one that you can do at home for sure. So I kept looking through and I found this one. So let me grab one myself. I don't have a curtain rod, but I do have a tripod monopod. Go grab a rod, a broomstick handle, a curtain rod, you know, a table leg, whatever, a stick. Grab something. This is a tripod monopod because I'm in a studio. This is what I got. Okay, so grab that, blindfold yourself, and have a friend tap on the rod or tap on things around your house. And even blindfolded, you're going to have a good idea of where on the rod they touched. A 2018 study in Nature and another one in 2019 in Current Biology both looked into this concept. And honestly, it's been looked at for centuries. Descartes wrote about it. Blind people were using tools to enhance their touch and they wanted to know what was happening centuries ago. And this is the ultimate touch illusion because your brain treats the tool like it's part of your body. It's the primary somatosensory cortex, the posterior parietal cortex, both regions for touch working together to create an extension of your body using the Pacinian receptors. In 400 trials with only 16 people, mind you, they guessed touches on the rod correctly 96% of the time. So either those 16 people were really good, they felt, or perhaps this is something that the brain is really good at doing. They even looked at their brains and the timing of the signals from the rod that they were holding or a touch on their own arm were extremely similar, only about 20 milliseconds from the touch on either spot to recognition in the brain. Now, you might be wondering, if this is valuable, why do you need to know it? Well, it's really cool for people with phantom limb pain. Phantom limb pain is the idea that you still feel a limb that no longer exists. So imagine you got in a car crash and your limb was still attached to you after the crash, but it was amputated in a surgery later. You might have had a pain in your hand during, you know, the recovery period. And once it was amputated, your brain never resolved that pain. It was like an unread email in your inbox that you can't access, but you can still see the notification. Whew, that would be really horrible, right? Now imagine that it was with pain though. So you're amputated at the elbow, but the brain thinks your hand hurts. It's almost like the brain is pinging your limb and finds nothing. This illusion can convince people with that affliction that the fake hand is their hand. It's like tricking it into thinking it's there, and you can treat the pain on the fake hand and treat the phantom limb pain. You can do this with a mirror box where you stick your hand in and you can see your other hand. You can do this with VR, which is really, really interesting. You put on VR goggles and then within the VR space, you treat the phantom limb pain and people come out of it and they feel treated. There's a caveat, of course, that methodologies of studies on this, especially with VR, are a bit shaky. That doesn't mean it doesn't work for some people, but it's not a generalizable scientific-y thingy. Okay, I'm just gonna point that out because, you know, science show. The illusion though is real. The treatments are a bit more researchy is neededy. It's not the same as the rubber hand. You don't own the tool, but you recognize that it is part of the body or connected to the body. It shows the power of the brain to extrapolate and adapt. So speaking of that, if you can do that with a rod, just a stick, what about with technology? You've probably heard of haptic technology. Haptic means touch and motion, and most commonly the sense of like a clicky MacBook, right? Not actually physically clicking. If you turn the power off, nothing happens. It's a vibration. So imagine the vibration of something like a phone when you touch keys on a keyboard, or the vibration of a click thing that doesn't actually click. What it is actually doing is vibrating, because that's how touch actually works. And so most haptic tech involves vibrations that simulate touch. Because again, that is what touch really is. It's not just contact. It's a specific level of vibration. In fact, some of the cells that connect to your touch system, some of the cells that we've talked about, they don't actually just feel deformations of their membranes. They can feel vibrations, which is pretty cool. So let's push the envelope here just a little bit into the edge of science. A 2019 Nature paper using synthetic skin, it's only a 4 centimeter square, used vibrations to feel what was going on. And that can be done with air, with vibrations, with lots of different things. But there are millions of receptors all over your body, and they all have different purposes. They're listening for different things. So this synthetic skin would pick up those vibrations and translate them to electrical signals and send it to the brain. It would be a long time before we get anywhere with this technology as a whole. But imagine a veteran who lost an arm. Their prosthetic is a tool. Not unlike the rod. If you touch it, your brain can extrapolate where you touched it. If you have that rod and you move and it moves, your brain is going to take over and own that prosthetic, not unlike the rubber hand illusion. You're essentially creating a live one. And if you add robotics and sophisticated computers with something like this synthetic skin that can translate stuff back to the brain using haptics or vibrations, you could create a prosthetic that the brain thinks of as our own hand, that could feel using the same brain regions as the rest of your body, and could do it all naturally. Can you imagine that? People have, and they're working on it. There is nothing out there in our sensation like touch. Touch is warm, it's soft, it's tacky. Gritty. There's a texture to skin, to fabric, a give and take in hair or the back of someone's hand, the electricity that we feel when we touch someone that we have a crush on, all of that and so much more. It's not just a signal going to the brain. Touching is so much. After all of this is over, go touch someone, you know, hug them, hold their hand. When you hug them, by the way, hug them for at least 20 seconds, because that's when you're gonna release those feel-good hormones. Of course, make sure you have their permission, consent, very important. Sit close to people who are comfortable with that. Hold someone's hand, even a friend. Hold their hand and tell them they are important to you. Even if they're not a sexual partner, this is not a sex thing. This is a friend thing, this is a contact thing, a connection thing. You'd be surprised how much a touch like that will connect two human beings, no matter how. Be emotionally open to telling your friends that you love them and miss them, because I have really come around on that in my adult time, and I really can't express how much it has changed my relationship with my friends. To say to my friends, I love them, has changed some of our relationships only for the better. If you can't touch someone physically, touch them emotionally. Give them a gift, send it to their house, write them a card, write somebody a letter. That will help because you were part of it. You could also do something even simpler that's really popular online right now. Learn to dance. I know many people only dance when they want to bang. Dancing is not sexual. Dancing is moving with music. We use it as a kind of gateway into sex, but that's not what it is. Dancing is fun. Dancing is friendly. You can dance with friends, with grandmas, with strangers, but you have to touch someone to dance. Another way that you can get touch without having an emotional connection that is maybe overwhelming, get your nails done. Guys, do this. I love getting my nails done. It is awesome. Not only do they look nice, but it's nice to have someone massage your hands and your legs, and it's professional touching. And because of that, everyone is consented and you're gonna feel good afterward. Touch is serious stuff. It is fundamental human things. And though we all recognize that people are gonna be missing it if they lose their sight, if they can't hear anymore, you can't taste or smell, when you ask somebody, oh, what sense would you lose if you could lose one? No one says touch. The loss of touch is either a joke or some kind of morbid superpower or just something to move the story along, because actually losing touch would be devastating. Touch is amazing, and I hope that after all of this, you now understand how much more fidelity you have with your body. So we're talking about touching things, and that stimulates our tactile sense, right? But it's not just like randomly touching stuff in your environment. You want to be more tactile during this stay-at-home time when we're physical distancing. So maybe you want to craft or draw. There's a drawing class on Skillshare that's really good. I'm obsessed with coffee, and making coffee is super tactile. You're grinding and you're pouring. You're wondering how brewmasters put flavors in the beer and make beer in general? You can learn that on Skillshare. Everyone at home right now is doing sourdough recipes on my Instagram, like everybody. But you can learn about dough on Skillshare too. Skillshare is an online community of creative learners, and we're teaching and learning all the time with each other. Things like graphic design and habit formation, marketing or business, web development, video, music production. I've learned things for Una Dose of Trace on Skillshare. And for the first 1,000 people who click this link, you're gonna get Skillshare Premium for free for 2 months. And if it's for free, it's foamy. If you try Skillshare, you're gonna support Una Dose of Trace, so you can feel good about that, and you get a thing. And now that we're in our spaces all the time, I wanted my space to look nice. So I went to the class Style Your Space, Bringing Creativity to Interior Design, and it's so cool to start to understand that if I put this thing here and that thing there, I'm starting to make the room look better and more comfortable, and not just cluttered, like I just scattered things around the house. Again, you can try Skillshare Premium for 2 months for free with my link right here. Skillshare loves creative and curious people who are lifelong learners, and I was like, I know some people like that. And you trying it for free supports me making more of this show, so thanks if you do. Speaking of the show, let's go back. Right now, millions of people are living in a world without touch, not just in prisons like I mentioned earlier, not just without limbs like I mentioned earlier, or not people with disorders that I mentioned earlier. Everyday humans everywhere in the world, including all of the people in prisons and with no limbs and people with disabilities. This COVID-19 virus has driven us apart physically and emotionally. And I would hope that this experience that we're all sharing everywhere in the world will give us empathy and understanding for each other. We would get a little bit of an overview effect. Astronauts feel that kinship to the Earth because they are held apart from it. They can only look out their windows. And this is the same thing that is happening to us. It's like a touch overview effect. And I don't know about you, but I'm gonna do a lot when we're allowed to go out. I'm gonna go on hikes, and I'm gonna have dinner with friends, and I'm gonna go to the beach and, you know, lay on the grass and roll around like a doggy, and it's gonna be great. I was already a hugger, but I'm gonna hug even more, and I'm gonna really hug. You never know. I'm gonna do as much as I can. When our largest organ, our skin, filled with millions of receptors, comes into physical contact with someone else's largest organ, it is meaningful. Even if it's casual, even if it's accidental, even if it's completely innocent, it means something. When was the last time you let yourself be touched? When was the last time you touched someone? Think about it. And remember that when you can touch anyone that consents anytime you want. I leave you with this poem titled First Date. On Monday, I saw a boy. On Tuesday, I heard his name. On Wednesday, I touched his hand. On Thursday, I tasted chocolate. On Friday, I smelled roses. On Saturday, we went on a date. The author is Vera Diana Trullio. They're 11. It's amazing. Reach out and touch someone, my friends. Subscribe for all of the episodes in this series of Una Dose of Trace. Please tick that subscribe button. If these episodes are valuable to you, please let me know so that I know to keep doing them. This is the first time I've tried it on this channel. I really enjoy it. I think it's really fun. You get a little more of me in them, which I really love. And I feel like we have a better connection. So let me know what you feel. You know, literally, let me know what you feel. Okay. Thank you for sticking with me all of this way. Wow, I think my voice is going. This Dose of Trace experiment is over for now, but I really want to know your thoughts. So tell me in the comments, send me a tweet, shoot me an email, whatever makes you feel more comfortable. You can join my Patreon, and you can find this whole thing as a playlist here. If you want to talk to me, you can join my Patreon. We have a Discord where we talk to each other all the time. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. I hope that you are keeping your hands clean. I hope you're all safe, and I will see you in the future.